chapter 1 in verses 16 and 17. And we'll touch on these to get us back where we were. In chapter 1, 16 and 17, Paul declares that he's not ashamed of the gospel that he preaches. And my take on that is that he either suspects there's some people that think that, or there is in fact some people who are thinking that Paul is, because of his absence from Rome, that he's got some reason for not coming to Rome, that he doesn't want to defend the gospel or something like that. It just seems that that's what he's driving at. And he counters that and says, that's absolutely crazy. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. Paul is not ashamed of the gospel that he preaches. And the reason he's not ashamed is that however that message appears to the world. Now, I know the world looks at it and says, yeah, this is just insanity. This is crazy. Paul says, look, I'm not ashamed of the gospel because however that message appears to the world, the truth of the matter, the reality is that message is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. So he says, I'm not ashamed of preaching that message because I know what it is. It's the power of God's salvation for everyone who believes. And in preaching, in the preaching of the gospel, Paul says that God's saving action is taking place. He says the righteousness of God is being revealed, is being manifested in the act of preaching the gospel. It's taking place. His saving action is taking place. He's rescuing lost sinners. So that concept of the righteousness of God from the Old Testament is saving work. He's rescuing lost sinners, and he's doing it by bestowing righteousness on them. God's saving work, Paul says in 16 to 17, is from faith to faith, and that it tracks the expansion or the extension of faith. Because faith is the means by which one appropriates or receives God's saving work. Then in chapter 1, verses 18 to 23, I'm not going to read it. We've read it, talked about it. I'll just put it up there while I quickly say something about it. But in Romans 1, 18 to 23, Paul begins to establish the universal reign of sin, the guilt of all humanity before God. This is going to occupy for a number of chapters. He's going to demonstrate that sin is universal and has an effect on all mankind, and he's doing that as a foundation for elaborating on the good news of God's justifying work in Christ, the blessings of which are appropriated through faith. He's first going to say, well, what is the significance of that? And he paints this universal reign of sin as the condition for which the gospel is the remedy. And it's an important thing. You see, so he spends quite a bit of time. He says the fact that God's saving work is taking place in the preaching of the gospel, that's of supreme importance. He said, I'm not ashamed of the gospel. 16 and 17 says, for, I'm not ashamed of preaching that saving message for the wrath of God. The fact God's saving work is being manifested, is being revealed in history, in the preaching of the gospel, is of supreme importance because the terrible wrath of God that ultimately is coming, it's already being previewed. It's already being this awesome wrath of God that is coming is already being previewed in his wrath upon the ungodliness and unrighteousness of human beings. So this is a matter of some urgency. It's important because we see in this preview the wrath of God. And he makes the point that the wrath of God against sinners both as previewed in history and as coming ultimately on Judgment Day, that wrath is just. That wrath is right. Why? Because God has revealed himself to all mankind through creation. You and I exist in a reality that tells us God is. It tells us that intuitively. You see, it is not a deductive argument. who's been despised for so long. Those efforts to bless that child, guide that child, have been despised for so long that the parent stops locking up his money or her money. And the child then takes it and uses it to buy heroin and thus to reap his punishment. You see, that's the consent that he's allowing them to, he's handing them over. Go ahead. Reap what you're so interested in. And you see what's happened. So it's like that idea. So the child who then winds up, is that a good life? Is the child enjoying it? No, the child has walked into that destruction. And so that's this concept here. John Stott, in his commentary, he says, God abandons stubborn sinners to their willful self-centeredness. I changed the spelling because he uses that English spelling. The willful self-centeredness and the resulting process of moral and spiritual degeneration is to be understood as a judicial act of God. That's the stuff he's handing them over. Friedrich Schiller's famous comment. He says, the history of the world is the judgment of the world. Isn't that interesting? The history of the world is the judgment of the world. Well, as God hands them over, we see the depths to which humanity sinks. Their lust, it finds expression in perverted sex, homosexuality being the example. He says, look where humanity goes. As I turn them loose and hand them over, they rush headlong into depravity. And so the example here, you have this lust finds expression in perverted sex exemplified by homosexuality. And Paul says that homosexuals receive in themselves the necessary or the due penalty for their error. The sexual degradation they embrace, that sexual degradation that they embrace in their rejection of God is punishment in itself. It's punishment in itself. It is part of God's judgment. Now, I understand, you know, that homosexuality in our culture, one word is it's called gay. But you know, whatever the etymology of that word is a reference to homosexuals, the implication of the label to modern ears of gay, the implication of that label is that the homosexual lifestyle is a kind of merry, carefree, fun-filled existence. But that's a lie. That's the lie. And what I find interesting is that though they've devised a euphemism to promote something for political purposes, if I don't go along with their euphemism and use it to help encourage people, well, no, it's gay. If I don't do that, now somehow I hate people. I'm not playing. You see, I'm not playing. But that's how it is. Jeffrey Sadno, he's a psychiatrist with degrees from MIT, the University of Texas, and Harvard. And he was a former fellow in psychiatry and child psychiatry at Yale University. And he writes in his 1996 book, Homosexuality and the Politics of Truth, that homosexual conduct is associated with numerous serious diseases, including several forms of cancer, and it's associated with a high suicide rate, the combined effect of which is a 25 to 30-year decrease in life expectancy. A 25 to 30-year decrease in life expectancy. It is anything but gay. And this is a footnote. The high suicide rate is not a product of homophobia, as activists like to charge. That's why, it's because people like you. But that's not true, because the rate is high in countries like the Netherlands, which are largely accepting of homosexual practice. Something else is at work. Okay, so this idea in our society, that's how it's called. Now, this does not mean, I hope I don't even have to say this to a gathering of Christians, this does not mean that homosexuals are beyond God's love and John 15:10. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. 1 John 2:4-6. Whoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. By this we know that we are in him. Whoever says he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. 1 John 5:3. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not burdensome. So, you know, the question is not about God's love for homosexuals. The question is, can a homosexual live in defiance of God and then continue to say he loves God when Scripture says, no, you don't? Now, we are people of the book. Isn't that right? We're people of the book because we understand that this book is the inspired Word of God. I go with the Bible. I go with the Bible. It doesn't make me hateful. It doesn't make me mean. In fact, I would submit to you, who really loves the homosexual? Who really loves the homosexual? Is it somebody who has the willingness to tell the homosexual the truth? Or is it somebody who enables them and helps to pave the road to their destruction? I think it's obvious to ask that question. See, as Christians, we have to, we must lovingly and patiently call all sinners, including homosexuals, to repentance. We need to celebrate their conversion. We don't sit there and go, oh, you know, well, I don't want something. No, we celebrate their conversion. And then we work to integrate them into the community of faith. Our culture appreciates the nobility of tough love in other circumstances, doesn't it? If you're raising a rebellious teenager, doesn't our society say, no, you can't do that. You're enabling them. You're enabling bad behavior. You're enabling that. You need to stand so I know they don't like it, but you need to have tough love because that's what it means to really love somebody. You love them enough to do something that risks their alienation from you. That's what it means to love them. We understand that in dealing with rebellious teenagers and dealing with alcoholics, but somehow our society is selling this thing that if you exercise tough love toward homosexuals, you're a homophobe. You're a homophobe, and we don't want that. So we kind of want, we back off, and we want to sit here and say, no, okay, that's fine. The church cannot be intimidated. We cannot be intimidated as Christ loved sinful humanity enough to endure public scorning in order to bless it. Did he not? Did he love sinful humanity enough to endure scorning in order to bless it? Well, then we as his disciples, we have to love homosexuals enough to do the same. Those who come to the light, those who embrace the truth and the message, they will be forever grateful. Those who reject it, they will recognize on that day that we really did love them. And we really were trying. I would rather stand next to a homosexual who rejects God on that day and have them look at me and say, you really did. You really did care about me. And so, I get it. Now, wait, that's not the message. You see, that's not the message. Well, Paul made clear that the church in Corinth included some who had been practicing homosexuals. He made that clear, right? He says in 1 Corinthians 6:9-11, or do you not know that unrighteous men will not inherit the kingdom of God? Our ears ought to perk up, because this is serious. He says, do you not know that unrighteous men will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor passive male participants in homosexual intercourse, nor active male participants in homosexual intercourse. We'll see a word about that translation in a second. Nor thieves, nor greedy persons, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. And some of you were these things. Some of you were these things. But Version says men who practice homosexuality. So look, don't tell me. Do not tell me that homosexuals are beyond the transforming power of the Spirit of God. Don't tell me that. What does Paul say? Am I going to listen to a culture that for political reasons insists that such transformation can't take place and mocks the idea, ridicules the idea with slogans like you can't pray the gay away? Am I going to listen to that, or am I going to listen to Paul that the Spirit of God has the power to transform us, to take God loves us so much he doesn't convert us to leave us where he found us. He transforms us. That's part of it. You see, who wants to be left? Who wants to live? I don't want to live the way I lived before I was a Christian. And I thank God that he has reached in and transformed. Oh, do you think you're so good? Do you think you're perfect? But no, I understand who I am. But I'm telling you that God has changed me and transformed me, that I am better today than I was then. Anybody who knows me, it's accurate. That's the power of God at work. And we belittle that when we deny it. Now notice that the sinfulness of homosexual conduct, it is rooted in the creation account. It's rooted in the creation account. Verse 20 speaks directly of God's creation. Verse 25 refers to God as creator. And verses 26 and 27, they allude to the creation of mankind through the use of the adjectives male and female, as you have in the creation account, rather than the nouns man and woman. This is an echo of the creation account, that God made them male and female. So this is rooted in the creation account. Homosexual conduct is contrary to nature, and that it's contrary to God's design of mankind as male and female, and his intention for their exclusive coupling. You see, so these attempts by activists to these days try to take Paul's words and say, look, Paul's condemnation, he's only referring to exploitative forms of homosexual conduct. A guy on the who is creation. God speaking into this creation is necessary for people to be redeemed. Okay, now in saying that not only Paul did it, this struck me as it never has before when I was preparing this. Paul down here in verse 32, he says, they, though knowing God's righteous decree that those who practice such things are worthy of death, not only do them, but also approve of those who practice them. It's saying that they not only do such wicked things, but also approve of those who do such wicked things. Paul suggests that their approval of wrongdoing by others is even more culpable than their own wrongdoing. That'll cause you to shake your head. You're like, oh, wait, that can't be right. That can't be possible. That your approval of wrongdoing is even worse than your engaging wrong. That seems to be what he said. They not only do them, but above and beyond that, they also approve of those who practice them. You say, well, how could that make sense? How is it possible? Doesn't it even make sense that approval of something could be more blameworthy than the actual practice? Let me read you a quote from a guy named Cranfield, C.E.B. Cranfield. He wrote 2 volumes. Commentary on the Greek text of Romans, certainly one of the most famous commentaries. I think he wrote in the 70s, maybe later than that, but here's what Cranfield says. The man who applauds and encourages others in doing what is wicked is, even if he never actually commits the same wicked deed himself, not only as guilty as those who commit it, but very often more guilty. There are several factors involved to draw attention to the fact, as does, I omitted a quote from Apollinarius, to draw attention to the fact that the man who does the wrong will often be under great pressure, as, for instance, that of passion, whereas the man who looks on and applauds will not normally be under similar pressure. It's not at all to diminish the guilt of the doer, but it is to reveal the greater culpability of the applauder. His attitude will very often be the reflection of a settled choice. Okay, I'm talking about, you think about somebody who's together, guy and a girl. Okay, they're in a situation, you see, where difficult passions arise. They need to be wise about getting in those situations. But you can see how where somebody who's standing at a distance and simply saying, You got enough now. You've got creation. You've got the whole part. You've got this thing. Well, what about the person that said, I got it down. I understand. Well, see, it's not just knowing those things. It is doing them, you see. So it shows one to be without excuse for sinning. If the sin of those who deny the truth is blameworthy, how much more the sin of those who acknowledge the truth by using it to judge others? Do you see the logic? By using the truth, see, by using and condemning others, you condemn in others the things that you do. You admit the propriety of your own condemnation. If I wind up using a standard and I condemn you for it and I break that standard, well, they're going to have it. Haven't I said, through my condemnation of your violation of the standard, have I not said, I agree, that's right, I'm using it to condemn them? So then how do you think if I turn around and violate it, what leg do I have to stand on? I'm in a worse position than the person who says, yeah, I got general revelation, you're right. I'm over here saying I've got this truth, and in fact, I accept the truth, I'm using it to condemn you, and yet I'm practicing the same thing. Well, you're in a pretty bad way. And so that's what Paul is doing here. He's turning this. See, with the Jew in mind, Paul would be referring to the kinds of things in that list from 29 to 31 as greed, envy, strife, deceit, malice, gossip, slander, arrogance, unfaithfulness, lewdness. Not so much homosexuality, which was condemned consistently. Old Testament, Inner Testament, early church, all the way through. It's not until very recently we have people saying, well, no, you know, I think this is really great. The Bible doesn't condemn it. Okay, I understand that when we come to the Bible is the standard. And we listen to it, but let me tell you, when you have a history of interpretation that is unanimous from Jew, early church, all the way through the Reformation, and it all says that's what the Bible, you better pay attention to that. Okay? That ought to be strong reinforcement when you say, look, it looks pretty clear to me, that's what the Bible says. And you look, well, how has it been understood? Everybody's understood it that way. You say, okay, I'm pretty sure I'm on the right track. That's not the standard. I get it. I get it. But we have to understand the proper role of those things. All right. So here we have, Paul is sitting here and says, look, the Jew here, he's referring to those kinds of things. For Jews to think they could sin and be exempt from judgment by birthright. You see, I'm a special person. I'm a Jew. I can sin and be exempt by birthright by being a Jew. To do that and to think that is to show contempt for God's mercy, for his abundant kindness and forbearance and patience in what? In withholding his judgment that is rightfully due the sinner. That's what he's talking about in kindness and forbearance, is that God is holding off his judgment, and he's doing that, and he's holding it off. He's holding off, and so for you not to come to repentance, you're abusing that kindness which is designed to bring you to repentance. You see the same concept. I get this thing pointed the right way. 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 through 10, especially verse 9. The Apostle Peter says, but do not let this one thing be concealed from you, beloved, that with the Lord one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like one day. The Lord is not slow concerning the promise, as some regard slowness, but he is patient towards you, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, at which time the heavens will pass away with a roar, and the elements will be dissolved by being burned up, and the earth and the works in it will be exposed. So you see this same idea where Paul is saying, listen, he says, look, God has been patient. He has been forbearing. He has not brought his judgment. And so when you wind up, you know, not recognizing that, you know, when you're sitting and think you can be exempt, you're comes